Bibliophiles of the internet, my name is Avri, and today I'm here to bring you my January wrap-up. Full disclosure, my main focus this past month was catching up on some early 2021 review copies I had. I'm trying to do a better job of balancing frontlist and backlist books this year, but obviously there were some things I wanted to review in a timely manner, so that's just kind of how it panned out. With that said, the first book I completed in 2021 was Lost in the Neverwoods by Aidan Thomas. I did a full, dedicated, spoiler-free reading vlog for this. I'm obsessed. It was fantastic. That vlog contains everything you possibly need to know before reading this, including all my thoughts. It will be linked down below, so definitely give that a watch if you would like. After that, I picked up my arc of As Far As You'll Take Me by Phil Stamper. This just came out on February 9th from Bloomsbury. It's an Own Voices queer contemporary story about Marty, a young musician who comes from a very conservative small town in Kentucky, and now that he's graduated high school, his plan is to hop on a plane to London and never come back. Obviously, his family doesn't know about this plan, so he's hoping he can land a paying gig or join an orchestra of some kind and find himself some stability before he gets found out. Content warnings for bullying, toxic relationships, manipulation, homophobia, religious bigotry, graphic descriptions of body dysmorphia and disordered eating, self-harm in the form of self-starvation, use of queer slurs, public outing, a near instance of sexual assault, anxiety and panic attacks, and several HP references. It's a little hard for me to review this one because I think it's both a necessary story and a challenging story. Just like in his debut, Stamper does a great job of exploring and highlighting mental health, especially in queer characters. Marty is an extremely anxious person in an extremely stressful situation. He's done this very spontaneous thing that has a lot of serious implications if he doesn't figure it out, and I thought that was well explored as the story progresses. I also really enjoyed the musical elements of the story. Marty is a classically trained oboist, and the story mentions a lot of music theory, music history, and technique that's really satisfying to read, and I think it perfectly captures that feeling of playing in a group as one collective sound. I also appreciate how the story deals with toxic relationships, especially because as a loner, Marty doesn't think he has a right to be picky about who likes him and who he hangs out with, and he unconsciously finds himself drawn towards people who reinforce the bad things he thinks about himself. I think that's something a lot of young readers will find relatable, finding themselves stuck in these relationships that don't serve them because they don't know how to navigate their way out of that and extract themselves safely. It's a story that definitely puts Marty through the ringer and is by no means an easy read, but I think he really is growing towards the end and learning how to show up for his real friends and himself, which I think is an important message. That said, I did have some problems with the story. The first major one was how the story handles eating disorders, so content warning for that if you want to skip ahead the next few seconds. So with the whole eating disorder, it kind of leads up to this one blowout intervention kind of moment, and then the topic is completely dropped after Marty's friends basically call him out. By the end, we're just supposed to assume that he's handled it, which feels disingenuous towards the recovery process, which is extremely challenging and can take a very long time. It's not as simple as just flipping a switch. And I also found it to be a missed opportunity to incorporate some intersectionality because body image and body dysmorphia has a very unique relationship to the queer community specifically, but that is never once addressed. My bigger problem with the story was how it fails at any point to acknowledge Marty's white privilege. Striking out on your own, buying an airplane ticket, moving to another country, trusting you'll find a job, knowing you have a cushion to fall back on even in the worst case scenario, that is a privilege that many people don't have. It kind of came off as a classic case of, well, white people can have problems too, and they can, and Marty certainly does, but you can have problems and still benefit from privilege, which again, he certainly does. I wrote a very thorough review on this one, which you can check out down below, but I had mixed feelings about it clearly, even though I still look forward to whatever Phil Stamper writes next, so I think I settled on 3.5 stars. After that, I read my arc of Love is a Revolution by Renee Watson. This also just came out on February 2nd from Bloomsbury. It's another Own Voices contemporary YA story about Nala Robertson, who agrees to go with her cousin to an open mic night for a community activism group called Inspire Harlem, and she finds herself very attracted to the MC, a young man named Ty Brown. When they finally meet, Nala panics, thinking she has to present herself as this woke radical activist in order to impress Ty, so she tells a few white lies in hopes of giving them some common ground and giving herself a fighting chance. But as the summer goes on and they get closer to each other, it gets harder and harder to keep up with those lies. Content warnings for some brief allusions to familial estrangement. It's no secret that I love Renee Watson. I think she so clearly writes from a place of love and celebration, and I love that so much. This book is no exception. It's really about learning how to love others and love yourself, even when it's difficult. I can see people not liking this story and not liking Nala specifically because she does play into that somewhat tired trope of lying to the cute boy in order to win his affection, and that's annoying. I get that. But I was able to afford her some more grace because I understood those lies identifies as coming from a place of deep hidden insecurity. Because she can't see herself as being worthy of love, she's not able to authentically transmit or give back that love. I feel like that's the crux of the story, recognizing that growth is never ending and that just because we love imperfectly doesn't mean we shouldn't love. Just because we grow imperfectly doesn't mean we shouldn't work towards growth in the first place. You really see that with the Inspire Harlem group, who Nala doesn't really feel connected to because they seem to take themselves so seriously, which is valid because the need for radical social change is serious. But Nala tries to challenge them to find the joy in their work, because if you don't experience joy, how can you inspire joy? If you don't challenge yourself to grow, how can you inspire growth in other people? And I think the story also shows us how activism and radical action doesn't always look like what we think it should look like. I do wish that Nala came to have a more complex relationship with the Inspire Harlem folks, who she initially thinks of in very shallow terms, and I also wanted to see more from the relationship with her mother as well, but overall, I still found this to be a story about radical and powerful self-love, and I gave it 4 stars. Then I listened to Say It Louder, Black Voters, Voices, and the Shaping of American Democracy, read and written by Tiffany D. Cross. It's a blend of memoir and historical nonfiction as written by Tiffany Cross, who is a Black journalist, political analyst, commentator, and television host who has spent her career challenging the pervasive whiteness in media and in politics. In this book, she takes a look at voter suppression, systemic racism, how Black voters are historically and systematically disenfranchised, and how they are crucial in every election, which tracks even with America's most recent elections and runoffs. Content warnings for explorations of racism, both incurred and documented, allusions to racist speech, quoting of racial slurs, discussions of police violence and murder at the hands of the police, in-depth discussions of white supremacy, and mentions of suicide, lynching, and racist killings. What's most interesting about this piece of nonfiction is that it specifically takes a behind-the-scenes look at how news and media are created and how huge a role the voices in front of and behind the camera and behind the screen play in shaping the political narrative of the United States. It chronicles the history of why communities of color, specifically Black communities, don't rely on the news as their main source of information and how there is a deeply broken trust between the democratic process and Black voters. It also meticulously picks apart why there is no such thing as the Black vote, and how polls and statistics do Black communities a disservice by failing to imagine them as nichely and diversely as white voters get to be. While other groups are broken down into more subsections like college-educated, single-parent household, blue-collar workers, the narrative always frames the entirety of Black voters as the Black vote, and that makes it harder to address their specific needs and concerns. A lot of the history it goes through also revolves around instances of suppression and injustice that often go largely unreported, even recently, which is largely contributed to the media's blind spots and the media's whiteness. It really boils down to where they're getting their sources from, who deems it a newsworthy story, who's producing the coverage, and who's delivering the stories. There's a lot of discrepancy there, and a lot of stories that impact Black communities are often only reported by independently run Black news publications, which don't get as much coverage as the major networks. It's really fascinating, it's all deeply connected, and I appreciated how Tiffany Cross really brought her media experience to the table and gave us a different lens. I do wish that her personal experience was more threaded throughout the entire book instead of only just the beginning, but this was still a really insightful book. If you're not white, it's most likely nothing you don't already know, but it's still very informative, and I gave it 4 stars. Then I picked up my arc of Can't Take That Away by Stephen Salvatore. This one comes out on March 9th, once again from Bloomsbury. I also buddy read this one with my friend Xander from This Cubed. Their channel will be down below, and you should definitely check them out if you haven't yet. This is an own voices, queer contemporary story about a young genderqueer singer named Carrie who dreams of being a diva and a superstar, and their heart is set on playing Elphaba in the school's upcoming production of Wicked. After getting the courage to audition, Carrie almost immediately faces backlash from their haters, their bullies, and even homophobic teachers and parents who don't think it's right for Carrie to play the part. So Carrie has to turn to their friends and their community in order to not only find their voice, but to also show the school district that they will not be silent. Content warnings for homophobia, bullying and misgendering, use of homophobic slurs, exploration of gender dysphoria, mentions of suicide ideation, allusions to depression and anxiety, exploration of familial death and grief, descriptions of Alzheimer's disease, homophobic attacks and hate crimes, graphic descriptions of injury, and physical assault. Yeah, there's a lot going on in this book. This is another case where it's very hard for me to review this book because I see its importance, I see what it was trying to accomplish, but I also struggled with it a lot. I see that it's aiming to be this radical and empowering story, but it takes so much to get there, and it expects the reader to wade through some very severe and explicit trauma first. To start with what I enjoyed, I think the story takes a very nuanced look at gender and genderqueerness. From every day feeling like another coming out, to having to rely on reductive mechanics and expressions of gender to telegraph what you're feeling that day, to still possessing certain privileges that come with your assumed gender even if you don't claim those things, all of that is addressed in this book. The story also seeks to normalize mental health and therapy, which is fantastic, and I think it definitely does. There's a lot to enjoy. There are strong elements of found family, there's an in-depth look at how to organize and protest, exploration of student rights, and even a pretty sweet romance where neither queer character has to earn the other person's love. All of those things are great. What left me feeling somewhat stranded as a reader was the ratio of queer trauma to queer joy. I am in no way implying that the two things can't coexist, and I'm not interested in censoring anyone or implying that there is some imaginary metric by which we can measure how much trauma is enough trauma. That's not how life works. And I don't think the issues in this story are in any way unrealistic. It's just hard for me to picture myself recommending this book to anyone and promising them an uplifting experience. Especially as a queer reader, it can be exhausting and tiresome to confront trauma after trauma, and frankly, I'm not fully convinced the payoff is worth the price. My bigger issue with the story is how the supporting cast is positioned in terms of inclusion, because Carrie is white and most of their friends are white, with the exception of two friends that they make over the course of the book, Phoebe, who is black, and Blanca, who is Latinx. These two characters assume a majority of the labor that goes into this budding protest, this Let Carrie Sing movement, and it's not a stretch to say that if it weren't for their labor and their expertise, the movement never would have taken off or had any lasting consequences. I have a problem with the white main character being the face of a movement, garnering recognition, and being seen as brave and groundbreaking while standing on the shoulders and the labor of black and brown folks. Obviously, I can't speak to the intentionality of that, but it's not a great look. And I think there were a lot of missed opportunities in the resolution of the story. I feel like the payoff doesn't quite land, and that any centering of joy and triumph really pales after such heavy-handed explorations of trauma. I wrote a much more thorough review where I really break down these issues further, which I will link down below, but I actually did not feel compelled to assign a rating to this book. On a much better note, my Patreon pick for January was Hamnet by Maggie O'Farrell, which I listened to on audiobook and was read by Elle Potter. It blends historical fiction with a fictional reimagining of William Shakespeare's family life, and it sets out to explore the inspiration behind one of his most famous plays, Hamlet, which most people know was named after his son who tragically passed away at a very young age. This story posits the Black Plague as the culprit behind Hamnet's untimely death, and we follow an omniscient narrator as we witness the beginnings of Shakespeare's family up until the creation of Hamlet. Content warnings for child abuse, descriptions of injury, graphic descriptions of childbirth and childbirth complications, some violence, outdated racial epithets, sexism and sexist slurs, physical assault, use of ableist language, exploration of contagious disease, death, child death, grief, and allusions to depression and depressive episodes. This book is devastating in the most beautiful way. It is every bit the tragedy you would expect it to be, and it absolutely destroyed me with its evocative emotion and incredible prose. It was billed as being in the tradition of Madeline Miller, which I think is a great comparison in terms of writing style and in its aim to basically take characters who exist at the periphery of a famous figure and granting them a fullness that makes that narrative even more complex. Full disclosure, I am not a historian. I don't know much about William Shakespeare's personal life. I read a few of his plays in school, and that's the extent of what I know, so I can't speak to the accuracy of this fictitious take on his life, but I can say that I was invested from beginning to end. I think what this story does so well is that it suspends you in a crucial moment and then sustains and builds that tension by slowly filling in the gaps and showing you how this perfect storm of people and choices all had to line up in order to make this moment. Right from the beginning, you're dropped into the story right when this contagious illness has breached the household, and Hamnet is desperately trying to find someone to help his sister who's fallen ill and he doesn't know what to do. Getting to a diagnosis, getting to what happens to Hamnet, takes more than half the book because we're understanding how this family was formulated, what kind of baggage the parents are bringing in with them, and how this loss is going to forcefully shift their entire dynamic. But I also love how the story takes liberties and injects these elements of almost surrealism or magic to make what could be a very commonplace story into something mystical because I think there is a sort of mysticism surrounding this family and what happened to them. I can see people not liking the story and saying the prose is too purple or too overworked, but I like pretty things that make me sad, so I loved it. And the build-up to the final line of the book was such a gut punch that I will not soon forget. I was totally blown away by this and I gave it 4.5 stars. After that, I picked up Last Night at the Telegraph Club by Melinda Lowe. I was kindly sent a finished copy by Penguin Teen, so thank you for that. This also recently came out at the end of January. It's an own voices queer historical story set in 1950s San Francisco in Chinatown, and it's about Lily, a Chinese-American teen who is just discovering her queerness. When she finds a pulp lesbian novel at the drugstore and a newspaper clipping advertising a male impersonator at a bar called the Telegraph Club, Lily is starting to discover this counterculture that's always been under her nose. And when a girl from school volunteers to take her to the Telegraph Club, she simply can't refuse. However, this was at the same time as the Red Scare, when Chinese immigrants and Chinese Americans were being closely watched and even deported due to suspected ties to communist groups. So if Lily is caught, it could very well tear her family apart. Content warnings for some instances of racism, deportation, xenophobia, homophobia, underage drinking, some graphic sex, brief mentions of miscarriage, some use of outdated racial and social epithets, and some exploration of familial estrangement and disownment. Queer historical fiction is one of my favorite things in the world because it is a purposeful reclamation of histories that have always existed but been systematically erased, and I think Melinda Lowe absolutely nailed it. This story captures such an impeccable sense of place and time, and it's set during a time where politically, racially, socially, everything would be stacked against a young, queer, Chinese-American, STEM-focused young woman such as this. And I think what's gonna stick with me the most about this incredible story is that it so easily could have been about trauma, repression, the internalization of homophobia, but it's not. Instead, it's about belonging, self-discovery, and resilience. Make no mistake, it is in no way a romanticization of the time period. It is a historically accurate narrative that addresses the very real obstacles and hardships that queer people of color especially had to face, and it's about Lily finding her way around those things. It's about how for every hardship there is a workaround, and how for all the ways society has repressed queer communities, there has always been a vibrant counterculture of queer people who love each other, who thrive, and who exist. That's why to me the Telegraph Club represents queer futurity and the normalization of queerness, which are things a young baby lesbian like Lily could never imagine if she wasn't able to see it. To see these women living their lives, having relationships, having jobs, celebrating their queerness out loud is life-changing, and it gives her strength to stay true to herself even if she's not able to say it, even if she's presented with an easier choice. I also really appreciate the intersectionality of the story, and we see how Lily's queerness could have serious implications during this time of the Red Scare, and also how this queer counterculture has barriers to entry and understanding that don't account for much outside of whiteness. There's also a lot of parallels in here surrounding the idea of performance, performing whiteness, performing straightness, performing gender, performing the role of the perfect Chinese daughter, and how the truest parts of ourselves don't simply disappear when we have to occupy different roles and spaces. Honestly, I love this book so much, and I could say so much more about it. Again, I have a more thorough written review down below if you want to read even more of my thoughts. I do think the ending wrapped up a little bit quickly, but this is still an absolute favorite, and I gave it 4.5 stars. And the last book I finished in January was my arc of Winter's Orbit by Everina Maxwell. This recently came out from Tor on February 2nd. It's a queer space opera about this galactic empire made up of alliances and treaties between planets, and when the story starts, one of the Iskut representatives dies under very mysterious circumstances, and a new marriage alliance is needed to keep the system afloat. Enter Prince Kiem, who is considered a washout and a liability as a royal, and who's mostly kept around for decorative purposes. The emperor decides that he's the only eligible royal to marry the Tan representative Count Jainan in his recently deceased cousin's place. And so Kiem and Jainan are rushed into this arranged marriage, and they have to convince the public and the political authorities that their marriage is real and viable. The only problem is that their feelings may not be as put on as they think. Content warnings for instances of past domestic abuse and emotional abuse, some violence and injury, and also the use of medical, psychological torture devices. I was so pleasantly surprised by this book. It's hilarious, it has great banter, it uses some of the best romance tropes, and it's like epic sci-fi meets murder mystery while actually overtly being a romance between two disaster gays. When all is said and done, I laughed, I swooned, I bemoaned the emotional constipation of both Kim and Jainan, and overall, it was great. I really enjoy the emotional stakes in this relationship because not only do Kim and Jainan seem to be polar opposites, but they they both have a chip on their shoulder and something they're desperate to prove by successfully touting this marriage to the public. Kiem, like I said, feels more like a decorative royal who doesn't get taken seriously, and Jainan is more straight-laced and duty-bound, who thinks he's not a desirable partner because he's so serious. And then a wrench is thrown in their already awkward, delicate relationship when internal security names Jainan as a potential suspect in this murder case. So I like that we not only get a series of romantic blunders, forced proximity, and an obscene amount of queer yearning, but there's a mystery and conspiracy unfolding in the background that really lends itself to developing the main relationship. On the one hand, that mystery element challenges the trust between Kim and Jainan, which is already tentative at best because they're basically strangers. On the other hand, it strengthens their relationship and unites them in a common cause. They both want to clear Jainan's name and discover the truth, and that's part of what allows them to grow close. As partners, they bolster each other, they strengthen each other, they recognize each other's weaknesses and strengths even more clearly than their own, and they make each other better, and that's exactly my favorite kind of romance. Over the course of the story, they're not only healing each other, but they're healing the divide between their two planets, and the divide between what is just and unjust in this political system, which I think is great. I do think the mystery elements were a bit convoluted at times, and there was maybe one too many characters, but I still love this. I pre-ordered my finished copy before I even got to the end, and I gave it a solid 4 stars. So those are all the things I read in January. We had some hits, we had some misses, and a pretty good variety in terms of genre and demographic, which is exactly what I'm always going for, so I would call it a success. If you've read any of these books yourself, feel free to drop by the comments down below and tell me what you think. But that's everything I have for this wrap-up today. Until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.